Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you enjoy what we are going to discuss today. It's about the sacred ecology. I'm going to be a little personal at the beginning and tell you how I got into it. Basically, I'm a historian. My doctoral work is in ancient Indian culture, Hindu iconography especially. But environment has always been a passion with me. And I thought the one way I could contribute was to have training programs for teachers, students, which became the CPR Environmental Education Center. But then after some time, you know, you feel, how long am I going to teach? I'm talking about 45 years ago. And I wanted to see some change which I could bring in. This was a time when there were terrible confrontations between the forest department and the people. The forest department would fence in an area, plant. People would go at night, cut the fencing, pull out the saplings. So I said, this obviously doesn't work. And I said, you know, there has to be something which works. And that is when I went around and I found that there is a tradition in India. It's an all India tradition. It doesn't belong to any state. You can go to Kashmir, you'll find it. You can go to Kanyakumari, you can find it. From Dwarka to Dibrugarh, you'll find it. That is the tradition of sacred groves. I'll tell you about this more tomorrow. But I found that there, people revered the forest on their own. They took good care of it. They were absolutely certain they would not cut it or bring any harm to it in any way. So that is when I said, okay, let us take up restoration. Because what has happened also to these sacred groves is that over the years, they've got degraded agricultural activities. People have taken over some of the land, development, roads going through, so on. So they had to go back into a pristine condition. And I thought this was the best way. And I'm glad I did, because today I can look back and say, okay, I restored 53 groves and 8 sacred tanks. And they're all maintained very well by the people because of the sanctity attached to it. And that is why I got involved in the sacred ecology. And I said, what is the sanctity that people are so attached to? And then you find that in India, all of nature is sacred. Now, this is a very long tradition. And over here, you'll find that the earliest scene of worship in India is in the Indus Saraswati, what you call Indus Valley civilization. There is a scene of tree worship, a man worshipping a tree. It's a stylized pipal tree with what is probably a yaksha or spirit of the tree. You know, people are so bothered about what the scripts contain that they do not see what the pictures on the seals contain. The picture speaks 1,000 words, so you don't have to know what the whether the script is Sanskrit or Tamil or Hebrew or Greek, whatever it is. This is a tree. There is a figure inside the tree with a horn, a man with a horned headdress. Another man outside is worshipping. And that's a very definite scene. Behind is a ram, obviously something kept for sacrifice. Next to the man is a head. Now, these are all figures of worship, and at the bottom, there are 7 men. We have the tradition of the Saptarishi. So is this what they are? Very likely. This is the oldest scene of worship in Indian archaeology. And what is very important is that it is the worship of the tree. So that is how old our worship of the ecology is. And I want to just, before I go into specifics, I want to just show you how this continues right through Indian culture. You have the worship of the tree. The first one is again the pipal. Those of you who have any rural backgrounds, you will know that women do go around the pipal tree 108 times, or at least 3, 7, 9 times every day. Then you have next to it the kejri, and on a platform, and in every village, you will find that there is a tree with a platform around it, and that is a sacred tree. You just have to go to the nearest village in Gujarat, you'll find it. The swastika, of course, is universal. And the last one is very interesting because it is a woman sitting on a tree which is obviously the Khejri, which is very sacred to the Bishnois in Rajasthan, and a tiger below. Now, who could she be? It's not just one seal. There are many, many seals like this, with this exact reproduction. And then I went through Sanskrit literature, Tamil literature, and in Tamil literature, as we go on, you will see, you have the description of the five landscapes. And in the landscape called Pale, or the desert, you have the goddess is the reigning deity of the desert. Her tree is the Kotran, which is a prickly tree, like the, probably the Khejri, the acacia. And her animal is the tiger. So it's amazing how these things continue right through Indian culture. And again, you have the three-faced Trimukha, horned yogi, who is Pashupati. Trimukha, why do I call him Trimukha? Because Elephanta, the famous three faces are called Trimurti. They are not Trimurti. The Elephanta three-faced figure is a Trimukha Shiva. So the same Trimukha you have in the Indus Valley, surrounded by animals, who is Pashupati. The same horned god is also the god of the Gonds in Central Asia, in Central India. The Gonds and the Maria Gonds. If any of you comes from Madhya Pradesh, you would know. And you have him, the middle one, he is beneath the peepal tree. And so you have the same traditions continuing. I'm just giving you this introduction to show you how there is a continuity right through Indian culture. And the last is a profile of a bull over what is called a yupa. It's a sacrificial post. Now, I'm just bringing this in because there is this controversy, which comes first, which comes next. Are they simultaneous? Are they not? You have the Indus Saraswati, you have the Vedic cultures. The Veda talks about the yupa. The word yupa comes from the Veda, Rig Veda. And they talk about the sacrifice of the bull also. And this is the scene which the Rig Veda describes in words and which you are seeing in a picture. So, we do not know what the Indus seals say. As I said, I think the pictures tell us enough. And even if I don't know what the script says, it doesn't matter. But then we do have Vedic literature, which in my opinion was practically simultaneous with a lot of the Indus cities. And all of nature in the Vedas was a divine part of an indivisible life force which united the world of humans, animals, and plants. The Vedas are dedicated to the Devas, who are shining ones. Now, who are the shining ones? They are the various planets in the sky. And whether it's the rain or the wind, they are identified with these shining ones who represented the stars in the firmament and forces beyond human knowledge or control. So man had to recognize that nature was superior. He could not control it. And he had to therefore resort to prayer to win the cooperation of the winds and the rains to ensure the regularity of the monsoon, to control earthquakes, because as you know, the Vedas took place in a region where the Indian plate meets the Eurasian plate. And you'll see right through history, it's constantly full of earthquakes, which is why we've had so many invasions from the northwest. You know, I have been working a lot on environmental history too. And it always bothered me, how do they say Babur walked into Delhi, walked right through? Did nobody stand up and fight him? And then we had this massive project where we documented all the environmental events. And I found that just before Babur came to India, there was such a massive earthquake in the northwest that probably people could not stop and fight him. So this is the situation. So they had to pray to the forces of nature, and they realized nature was stronger than them. So what was this nature? Now, we say Indra fought this. No, but if you read the Vedas, you'll find that Indra is the rain, Agni is fire, Vishnu is the sun, Pusha and agriculture, Ushas is dawn, Dios Pitra is the father of the shining ones, Prithvi is mother earth, the rivers were sacred, and so on. So the concept of the sacred environment was established in the Vedas, and it has gone through right through Indian literature. So the sages of the Veda, Rig Veda, were very clear that the natural world, its ecology, the environment were very important. And it dedicates a whole, the Rig Veda dedicates a whole hymn to the rivers, the Nadi Stuti Sukta. And the hymn to the earth, the Prithvi Sukta, consists of stanzas in praise of Mother Earth and nature. And in this comes creation. And I don't want to go into that because there's a beautiful poem which is in the book, Hinduism and Nature. You get, I'm giving, gifting those books to the department, to Professor Danino, so you can always read it. Please read the Nasadiya Sukta, which has been described by Carl Sagan as India's tradition of skeptical questioning and unself-conscious humility before the great cosmic mysteries. And finally, I'd like to quote from the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. In the beginning, there was the self alone. He transformed himself into man and woman. Later, he transformed himself into other creatures, bipeds and quadrupeds, that is, the birds and the animals. In this way, he created everything that exists on earth. So they are, all these creations are the Lord himself. All that creates, that exists on earth, in water, and in the sky. And he realized, I indeed am creation, for I produced all this. And in the Bhagavad Gita, I'm not, this is not a historical lecture, so I am jumping from the Rig Veda to the Bhagavad Gita, which goes through a couple of, which goes through a millennia. But here Krishna says, I am the earth, I am the water, I am the air. So the environment is sacred. It's sacred in all Indian religions because it is the Lord himself. In our prayers, you know, every ritual, and even sometimes, you know, if you have a function, you will find that there is a Shanti mantra. And there is this mistaken belief that they're talking about Shanti in the world and all. No. The Vedas say that if the environment is at peace, there is automatically peace on earth. So you have Om Dhyau Shanti. I'll just read out the translation. May peace radiate in the whole sky and in the vast ethereal space. May peace reign all over this earth, in water, in all herbs and the forests. May peace flow over the whole universe. May peace be in the Supreme Being. May peace exist in all creation and peace alone. And may peace flow into us. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Because if there is peace, there will not be strife among people. And I think you will all agree that all the wars, everything, it's over land, it's over water. Karnataka and Tamil Nadu, from where I come, are fighting over the Kaveri River. Somewhere else, India and Pakistan are fighting over water, over land. So if there is peace in the environment, you will have peace among people also. Now the word dharma has been described in so many ways. Aapka dharam kya hai? Meaning, what is your religion? Dharma is not religion. Dharma is righteousness. And what is this righteousness? The basis of Hindu, Buddhist, and Jain culture is dharma or righteousness, incorporating duty, cosmic law, and justice. It is sanatana or eternal. That is why the religion is called Sanatan Dharma. For it is without beginning. Yes, let me just read it and then. It is without beginning or end, and it supports the whole universe. Every person must act for the general welfare of the earth, humanity, all creation, and all aspects of life. Dharma is meant for the well-being of all living creatures. Hence, that by which the welfare of living creatures is sustained, that for sure is dharma, says the Mahabharata. Yes?
So my question is that dharma nirpeksh means what you said, dharma is not religion.
No. So, it has come to mean religion, but dharma is not religion.
So what does secular means then?
No, secular doesn't come into this at all. We are talking about dharma as a law of righteousness.
So secular translation, dharmanirpeksha, is not right then?
No, look, in today's context, it may be correct. Today it is used this way, but the word dharma does not mean religion. In Sanskrit, it is used, dharmanirpeksha and so on. But that is not the meaning of the word dharma. Okay? The word dharma means righteousness. And Sanatan dharma, it means eternal righteousness. Righteousness is not righteousness for you or for me. It is righteousness for all earth, for all creation, for plants, animals, for all time. So, dharma, Sanatan dharma is eternal righteousness. That is what this religion should call, actually called itself. But dharmanirpeksha, you know, today, if somebody asked me in Hindi, they would say, aapka, or even I would say, aapka dharam kya hai? But that is a modern meaning. See, words change their meaning, even in the English language and so on. In every language, words change their meaning. But this is what dharma means, and I'm quoting from the Mahabharata. Panth nipeksh, maybe. Sampradaya nipeksh, all these are correct words. But dharma nipeksh means without righteousness. It cannot be dharma nipeksh. That means, I mean, every religion claims righteousness. So I don't think you can have a religion or anything which says that without righteousness. So, coming back, nature was a part of an indivisible force which united the world of humans, animals, and plants. Now, unlike the Semitic religions, where the Bible says, go forth and conquer nature, the Bible says that the plants and the animals especially, I have created them for you, says God, so you can use them. But in Hinduism, there is no mastery or control over the world of animals. It is something that everybody, we are all part of an indivisible force which is united. So what is nature? Nature is revered as a mother, like you would revere your mother, obeyed as a father, and nurtured as a beloved child. And they are the natural phenomena, that is the rain, the winds, the thunder, the earthquakes, the bad, the good, everything, are the manifestations of the gods and not the gods themselves. That's why even Indra and Vayu are not the supreme being. They themselves have to attain their status. So they are manifestations, one particular manifestation, but they are not the supreme being. Only Krishna says, I am the supreme being. But the rest, they are not manifestations. They are only, they are not the supreme being. They are only manifestations. And they express the principles that govern the world and the cosmic order. Now, drought was feared then as now. And I think this is the period when the Saraswati was drying up and we suddenly have the desertification of Rajasthan, Cholistan. Because constantly, if you read the Rig Veda, there is a battle between Indra and Vritra. Indra is rain. Vritra is the demon of drought. And Indra calls Vishnu, the sun, come forth and let us destroy Vritra. And they fight Vritra and they destroy Vritra. So this is an anthropomorphic representation of the diverse forces of nature. And I think this is a period when slowly the dependence on the great river that was the Saraswati was going. Don't forget that was the easternmost. And as it was going, they became more and more worried about drought. And this is the time people were moving east. So a lot of our history also, you can see through the environment. In fact, it's very sad that in school, none of us are taught environmental history. Because if you just read the history of the environment, you will know why certain things happened at certain times. Vritra. Mm. Yeah. Okay. Vritra is not really a serpent. He's a serpent like a dragon. If you see the description, maybe he is an inspiration for the later Adisesha. But Adisesha is a very benign character. Vritra is not. He is disliked. He is a demon. And he is a demon of the drought. So Ahi of Vritra in the Rig Veda. See, the Rig Veda is very different from later literature. That is why even when he asks about dharma nikpeksh, it's something very modern, maybe 300-400 years old. We're talking about something that's about 4,000, 5,000 years old. So at that time, Vritra was a serpent, but it was the drought. They probably saw the sky and they probably saw this horrible drought slowly coming up on them. Just imagine the river is drying up and the desert is coming in. Those of you living in Ahmedabad, every time I come here, I see more of the desert coming into Ahmedabad. So it's probably they were living with it and they were trying to do agriculture in that area. So it's different from the later snake stones. Those are all symbols of fertility, and tomorrow I'll talk more about that. Now, while Purusha is the masculine aspect of creation, Prakriti is the feminine. So Purusha and Prakriti together make up nature. Prakriti is dynamic, causing change, the primal motive force, an essential part of the universe and the basis of all creation. It's like Shiva without Shakti is Shava. Similarly, Purusha and Prakriti come together to make up the dynamism of nature. And that becomes Brahma, the creator, Vishnu, the preserver, and Rudra, the destroyer of the wicked. The idea being that the God is one, but gods are differently named concept of the one being. That comes in the Rig Veda itself. Now, this cosmic, primordial cosmic matter of nature is made up of five elements, the Pancha Bhuta, Prithvi, Vayu, Agni, Apa, and Akasha. They are known as the Pancha Mahabhuta. And their proper balance and harmony are essential for the well-being of all humankind. And the maintenance of this harmony is dharma. It is a righteous duty. So that is why I say it's not religion or anything else. So here you have the Pancha Mahabhuta. And their proper balance and harmony are essential for the well-being of humankind. Now today we don't have it. Look at what's happening to the air. We have such polluted air. So you have polluted plants, you have polluted earth, everything. So unless they are in harmony with each other, we do not have a good, healthy life. And that is a dharma or righteous duty of every human being. How many of us do it? That is the question. If we can go back to this and take what our scriptures told us was our dharma, our righteous duty, world would be a better place. Now, Agni and water are regarded as the sustainers of life. Agni, for it is energy. Waters, I don't have to tell you what water is necessary for. It's medicinal, it's for survival, it dissipates disease, medicine, so on. And Agni is fire, and it's so important because energy. What gave man the control over animals? It's because he, with two hands, he learned how to catch hold of fire and threaten, so the wild animals could keep away. That is why the Rig Veda, the very first hymn, is addressed to Agni. So life is an expression of the gods, second only to Agni, who is the giver of life on earth. There would be no life without Agni. Thus, the Vedic people recognize the presence of God in everything. And Trita, an ancient Vedic water deity who lived in the remotest places, guides Agni in the process. Now, we talk about biodiversity. Now, this, unfortunately, the picture I had got, I didn't get, but wasn't coming out properly. But I want to show you this picture of Shiva Parvati. They have two sons, Ganesha and Kartikeya. Shiva has the bull, Durga has the lion, Ganesha the mouse, and Kartikeya the peacock. Now, look at what it symbolizes. This biological diversity, today we all say biodiversity, it's a very beautiful word. It's exemplified by the family and habitat of Shiva. His habitat is Kailasa with its snowy peaks. The stream of Ganga's water is the purity and the importance of water. Nandi is the world of animals. The serpents on Shiva's neck and body, they represent the toxicity in nature. The lion represents wildlife, the peacock, the avian species, and the mouse represents small underground animals. The significant aspect is the harmonious relationship between natural enemies, the lion and the lamb literally. In Shiva's household, natural enemies live in harmony with each other. When a devotee worships Shiva and his family, he or she observes the coexistence of and is influenced by the concept of ecological harmony and respect for biological diversity. So, the Prithvi Sukta tells us to behave suitably. O Mother Earth, you are the universe and we are but your children. Grant us the ability to overcome our differences and live peacefully in harmony. And let us be cordial and gracious in our relationship with each other, with other human beings. In fact, it's very interesting that the Prithvi Sukta, after all this, is praying for harmony among people, which I think you will all agree we need today. And that is through nature, that if nature is harmonious, Mother Earth, make us live in harmony, give us that strength. And the relationship between human beings and nature, the earth which possesses oceans, rivers, and other sources of water, which gives us land to produce food grains and on which human beings depend for their survival. May it grant us all our needs for eating and drinking, water, milk, grains, and fruit. So nature is the creation and the manifestation of the Supreme Being. The Bhagavata Purana says that all the elements, now Bhagavata Purana is much later in time. As I said, this is not a history class. I'm jumping from Rig Veda to Bhagavad Gita to Bhagavata Purana, which is 10th century. It says that all the animals, such as all the elements, such as space, air, fire, water, earth, the Panchamahabhuta, the planets, even animals and plants, directions, the trees and all, are but organs of the God's body. And what we are today is a result of our past deeds. So this is where karma comes in. So we are constantly making our karma, and we are the makers of our future. Hinduism has a definite code of environmental ethics. According to Hinduism, humans may not consider themselves above nature, nor can they claim to rule over other forms of life. Hence, traditionally, the Hindu attitude has been respectful towards nature. There is a very strong and intimate relationship between the biophysical ecosystem and economic institutions, which are held together by cultural relations. From him, all the seas and mountains, from him flow rivers of every kind, from him are all the herbs and their juices too, by which, together with the elements, the inner soul is upheld. And the Bhagavad Gita says, those who are wise and humble treat equally the Brahmin, the cow, the elephant, the dog, and the dog eater. This comes to a very important part of what Hinduism talks about nature, ahimsa. Ahimsa is non-violence in thought and action, in thought also. Because if I think, I want to kill that fellow, you know, I may not kill, but somewhere I'm going to influence somebody to go and kill. You know, I can just go on talking, I'd like to kill that person, I wish I could kill him, and somebody else will go and do it. So non-violence in thought and action. Ahimsa is India's unique contribution to world thought. No other country, no other culture, no other religion, nobody has got anything similar to ahimsa. It's first mentioned in the Rig Veda and the Taittiriya Shaka of the Yajurveda. And the earliest reference to the idea of non-violence to animals or Pashu Ahimsa is in the Kapisthala Katha Samhita of the Yajurveda. The Chandogya Upanishad is very clear. It uses Ahimsa as a code of conduct, bars violence against all creatures, and the practitioner of Ahimsa is said to escape from the cycle of rebirth. Oops. Prajapati is the creator and the protector, and people are advised to treat all species alike. We have no authority over animals. Rather, we have duties and obligations towards all creation. I mentioned this earlier. So it behoves us to give all species equal respect and reverence. For they may be reborn, for we may be reborn as an animal, bird, or insect in another life. There are no do's and don'ts in the religions of India, Hinduism, Buddhism, or Jainism. There is no God who sits in judgment. It is all cause and effect. One has to bear the consequences of one's own behavior, good or bad. So our future is in our own hands. So the most important aspect of Indian tradition is karma. And this is where our dharma comes in, our righteous action. It associates all species with birth, death, and rebirth. Even the Supreme Being incarnates himself. And people are responsible for their own behavior, and one's karmas or actions lead to consequences in a future life. Far from employing fatalism, now there's a Western concept that karma is fatalism. It is not. Karma gives tremendous responsibility to the individual and places in his own hands the key to his future. So if I lead a proper dharmic life, a righteous life, I can avoid rebirth in a way in which I would not like to be born, so, and I may be able to avoid all rebirth itself. It can only work itself out over a long period of time because we come with a karmic baggage, and in this lifetime we must try and get rid of our baggage. Therefore, the Hindu belief in reincarnation. Karma can be considered the moral equivalent of the law of conservation of energy, or the equivalence of action and reaction in the field of natural sciences. I just want to go through Jainism and Buddhism and show how some of these ideas were concentrated in these two. Now in Jainism, all life is also interdependent. Parasparopagraho jivanam. And their most important advice is ahimsa or non-violence towards all. This earth is our dwelling, our temple, our sangha, our vessel in which spiritual attainment is perfected, and all life is interconnected. So mutual coexistence is the mantra for sustainable development. There are five principles of Jainism, of which three are very important: ahimsa, non-violence; Anekanta, that is non-absolutism, right attitude; aparigraha, non-possession. You know, today's consumerism would do a lot of, would be helped if we all had aparigraha. I want this, I want the latest jeans, I want the latest shoes, I want, you know, I want. Today our wants are increasing exponentially. Buddhism, what does it say? Buddhism says the same thing. The entire world should be protected, and the world, though apparently divided, is undivided in its interconnection. This is what Hinduism, Buddhism, Jainism say. The world is undivided in its interconnection. Nature is inseparably embedded as part of a continuum of interbeing. Buddha, remember, he attained his enlightenment seated under a tree, the Bodhi tree. And he gave his first sermon in the deer park at Sarnath. So trees, forests, and gardens are sacred. I am rushing a bit. And there are many things. Does not befit the man of compassionate heart to kill another being, says Buddha Charita, who is helpless out of a desire for profit. How should one act when the fruit is transitory? So, you know, setting up all these slaughterhouses for export of beef and so on, which is going on in our country today, think about it. The wise live without injuring nature, just as the bee drinks honey and flies away without harming the flower. What a beautiful analogy. Its petals, its color, or its fragrance, like a monk, should wander in a village. And only actions that will bring welfare and happiness shall be carried out with mindfulness of discriminative wisdom. All actions must be regarded beforehand for their suitability and appropriateness of time and place. In Tamil literature, you have Thiruvalluvar, who wrote this beautiful Kural, which is full of aphorisms, and it is probably one of the greatest works on ethics and morality. And the greatest virtue, according to Thiruvalluvar, is non-killing and compassion towards nature and all life forms. This is the Bible of Tamil literature. Tamil literature also talks about the Sangam literature, the Ainthinai, the fivefold division, Kurinji, Mullai, Marudam, Nethal, Pale, presided over by Kartikeya, Krishna, Indra, Varuna, and Kotrave. Now, I mention this to show you how Kotrave is seen in 3000 BC in Indus Valley and again so much later in Tamil Sangam literature. And they have documented in great intensity every characteristic of each of these geographical landscapes, the flowers, the trees, the animals, birds, climate, and other geographical features. 5,000 years ago, the sages of the Atharva Veda said, the earth's attributes are for everybody, and no single group or nation has special authority. The hymn describes the earth as the mother of all species living on it. Let the whole of humanity, how much time I have, speak the language of peace and harmony, and let all living beings live in accord with each other. Then, of course, I go back to the Shanti Mantra. There was a writ petition filed by the owner of a commercial building in Chennai. In 2017, Justice Vaidyanathan gave a beautiful judgment. He said, our traditions and values passed down to us from our ancestors are not wrong beliefs. They are scientific, rational, and logical. That is why they worship nature. Even now, many of them who follow our ancestral beliefs continue to do so as they have got abundant sanctity. Referring to people worshipping soil, fire, water, space, and air, the learned judge said, it is not at all irrational. When nature gets the sanctity, it will not be ruined. Thus, nature was protected in those days. However, in the name of rationality, which we have in this post-colonial era, and also with the coming in of, you know, a kind of general anti-religion attitude, religious taboos were violated, the result of which we suffer these days. Tomorrow, I'm going to go into this in further detail. I'm just giving you the kind of background, the kind of religious ideas with which people have lived all over India. And tomorrow I'm going to go, as I said, through the whole country and show you that there is no tradition which is unique to any part of India. I wish I could say this is unique. It's not. And it's as if people, this geographical area that was Bharat, that is India, that is the land of dharma, of righteousness, had specific beliefs with which they looked after nature and the natural world. And none of it was wrong. It's only when we stopped respecting it. And why did we stop respecting it? We stopped respecting it in the name of science, in the name of rationality. I'm rational. Come on, don't tell me there's a god in the tree. Come on, don't tell me Ganga is a god, goddess. If Ganga is not a goddess, she's highly polluted. If we had worshipped her as a sacred being, we would have kept her clean. It's because we have lost that respect. If we had kept our trees as sacred, we would not have cut them and we would have lots of rain. We wouldn't be praying every rainfall saying, please rain, come, come. We wouldn't be doing that. And so on. And what are we doing to the air? I mean, we all see the news every night. Look at Delhi, where there is absolutely no air worth breathing. We have polluted the air. We are not respecting nature. And what are we doing to animals? The way we are mistreating them, ill-treating them, and this is an all-India phenomenon. I won't say any. Probably Gujarat is a lot kinder than other states, but so do you have unkindness in Gujarat. We have this intensive factory farming by which animals have become milk-producing machines, meat-producing machines. Was that how, what they were intended for? So we have to examine ourselves. And I feel that respect for nature, respect, belief in the sanctity of nature is the only thing that can save this earth, or at least slow down our roller coaster ride towards destruction. That is where we are going today. I mean, we talk about climate change. We see the glaciers melting. We see icebergs melting. That means the levels of the sea are going to go up and up. The coastal areas are going to be inundated. Do you know already about 24 islands in the Sundarbans have disappeared? So all along the coastline, we can see the waters coming in. What can we do? If only we could respect nature, and that the only way we'll respect it, we Indians are like that. If you say this is sacred, people will look after it. If you say, "Arey, there's nothing in it," we will go happily and destroy it. So please let us think about the sanctity of everything. I want to just end with some daily observances. You know, all over India, you have this Alpana or Rangoli column. It's the same thing. It's made of rice flour. Why do we do this? In the morning, women get up, clean the front of their house and do these beautiful designs. That is also to feed the ants. They go around the pipal tree. I'll go to the next one. And the pipal tree, do you know, it produces twice the amount of oxygen as any other tree. You can go and ask any botanical scientist in this campus. He will tell you. So that means our ancient people knew so much science that the pipal tree produces more oxygen than any other tree. That's why the Buddha, that's why Shiva, so many people sit under the pipal tree. Then why do we hang up mango leaves as a toran? We can hang up any leaf, but no, it's only mango leaf because it has antibacterial properties. Every part of India keeps a tulsi in the center of the house. The whole of India, we have this tradition of an open courtyard with the rooms around it. Whether you are from Gujarat or from Tamil Nadu or from UP, I have seen houses everywhere. You have these homes with a tulsi in the center. In the morning, the woman will go around and pour water and pray to it. And she prays to it because the tulsi prevents coughs, colds, fevers in a home. So they knew so much about its value. So it goes on. I mean, every aspect of our lives by which we respect nature is something by which we give reverence to nature, is something that will protect us. Finally, I must tell you that people knew Pradushana or pollution. Kautilya and Arthashastra says Pradushana should be awarded, punishment should be awarded. Still have time, okay. To those who throw dust and muddy water on the roads. A person who throws inside the city the carcass of animals must be punished. Now, if Kautilya were alive, probably every Indian would be in jail. Because we eat something, throw it. We litter the place. Please read the Arthashastra. Tomorrow I will quote much, much more from it about forest management and so on. If we just made the Arthashastra into our constitution, we would have a lovely country. Environmental pollution was identified several millennia ago, says the Mahabharata. From pollution, two types of diseases occur in human beings. The first is related to the body and the other to the mind, and both are interrelated. Coolness, warmth, we say garmi, thandi, you know, different medicines and so on, and air, these are the three virtues of the body. When they are balanced in the body, it is free of disease. And Charaka has predicted, due to pollution of weather, good old Delhi today, several types of diseases will come up and they will ruin the country. Therefore, he says, collect all the medicinal plants before the beginning of terrible diseases and change in the nature of the earth. So, this is what our own medicinal men, our scientists predicted years ago would happen to our country. Finally, the Durga Saptashati, Devi Kavacham says that as long as the earth is able to maintain its mountains, forests and trees, until then the human race and its progeny will be able to survive. So obviously the author of the Durga Saptashati saw in his time itself that the mountains, the forest. Why are mountains so sacred? Because they are the watershed. When the rains come, the water falls on the mountain. I mean, all of us learned that in school geography in the fourth standard. My grandson is learning it. The water comes, it goes, and it gets collected in pools around the mountain. So the mountain is so sacred for that reason, forests and trees. The family of Mother Earth, Vasudeva Kutumbakam, must promote Sarva Bhuta Hita. Now, our politicians keep saying Vasudeva Kutumbakam, that we are one family of the earth. But they don't say the second part of it. It's very convenient, which is Sarva Bhuta Hita, that is, do not harm all creation, all animals, all the other this thing. They say only Vasudeva Kutumbakam, that means you and I are brothers, sisters, fine. But our duty, our dharma is Sarva Bhuta Hita. Sorry? Yes, I'm not reading the whole thing. I just read that because the second half of the Yajurveda sentence says Sarva Bhuta Hita. That is something nobody says. They just leave it at Vasudeva Kutumbakam and say, we are all one. But then if we are one, we should also practice Sarva Bhuta Hita. That is what I'm trying to say. So Hindu traditions acknowledge that all life forms, human, animal and plant, are equal and sacred, and are thus even appropriately placed to take on contemporary concerns like deforestation, intensive farming of animals, which has got to stop because it's producing carbon dioxide, it's producing methane, and it's cruelty, it's absolute cruelty. I mean, I think, God, next life, let me not be born as one of the cows in a goshala, which is just... Which are all being ill-treated so much. And they are thus appropriately placed to take on contemporary concerns like deforestation, farming of animals, global warming, and climate change. So I want to just end by saying that these are three books which I am giving your department, but I would like to also mention this website. I think it's CPR EEC Envis. I'll give you the actual website name tomorrow, .nic.in. This is a website which we are maintaining for the Government of India, Ministry of Environment, where we are collecting the ecological traditions of the whole country. So which are the sacred animals, mountains, plants, gardens, rivers, cities and sites. Like, for example, Kashi, when I say city, to give you this thing, why is Kashi sacred? So there are a lot of things. The Ganga, that is where agriculture, rice farming began in that area. Then you have sacred forests, the groves, which I spoke about, water bodies, seeds. We will talk about all this much more in detail tomorrow. This is just an introduction to the subject, to give you a background, to give you what are the ideals which people used to protect the environment, and this, how did they do it on a practical sphere, that you will see tomorrow.